So my name is Zadi. I'm with Informal Systems. Thank you for your attention in advance. So as you can see, I will talk about what I call the age of specialization and how that applies to the Interchain stack. And what I would like to talk to, what I would like to start the presentation with is an interesting insight that I had recently. And the insight comes from Steven Spielberg. Yeah, there we go. Steven Spielberg is one of the greatest movie directors. I have a lot of respect for his movies and his work. I'm a big fan of cinema in general. And Spielberg was the one who directed Jaws. That was a 1975 movie. And it was a huge blockbuster, okay? It defined actually what it means to be a blockbuster in the literal way, in that people were queuing along the block to wait for the cinema to have spots for them to watch the movie. So it was crazy. And then if you actually watch Jaws, what you will notice, and it's something that Spielberg actually talks a lot about when he reflects on his experience directing this movie, what you will notice is actually that you don't see the shark in that many scenes. And make no mistakes, if you didn't see the movie, I put here a picture from the movie, and what we see here on the right is some yellow barrels, and there in the distance we see a boat, and the main characters from the movie are on that boat. Now, what those characters on the boat know, and we, as the audience of the movie, we know that hooked to these barrels is a shark. Okay? So we know when the barrels are moving towards the boat, like the people on the boat, we know that the shark is approaching them. This is actually a great way to create suspense. And it's a great way to create suspense because what we don't know matters more than what we see. What we don't see matters more than what we see here. And by that, I mean that our mind, it fills in the gap. We know that the shark is hooked to those barrels, and we imagine all of these terrible things. And it's a great way to create suspense. This is what the movie specializes in, actually. So Jaws doesn't specialize in sharks. It specializes in suspense, in creating a good thrilling atmosphere, in an ambient of fear and anxiety. So it's a really, really good experience if you haven't seen it yet. And this is kind of the most important thing that I can mention about Jaws. If you actually look at the technology that they used in this movie, it looks something like this. This is how it looked. Again, it was 1975. What you see here is a mechanical shark. And it's like a mock shark, okay? It's missing many things. The point is that this was quite custom made for using it on the set. And it's missing many parts, as you can see. But it does have the crucial parts. It has the fin, because you gotta show the fin in the water to create suspense. It has the open mouth. And otherwise, it's very rudimentary. It can only go up and down, and it's very rudimentary. Actually, it would break all the time on the set. So the crew had a pretty terrible experience with it. They called the movie Flaws, because they thought it would be really bad, but it was a huge success. Also, it was 1975, so they had to use this. They didn't have computer-generated imagery or advanced things. Regardless of how flawed this machinery was, again, the movie was a huge success. And that's maybe what matters the most, because the way they achieved that success was through creative ways, like the barrels that you've seen, the shark fin, and so on, to create that suspense. And you might wonder why I'm talking about this at a Cosmos or a blockchain conference, and what does it have to do with that? What it has to do with it is that while I'm looking at this mechanical shark, I can't help but wonder, it makes me reflect quite seriously whether isn't this a lot like a blockchain, like the blockchain technology today. It's an imperfect machinery, and Spielberg with his crew, they used this imperfect machinery in very narrow, specific, specialized ways. Alongside it, they had other gadgets. So there was just one small gadget that was specialized for creating suspense, but they had other things. They threw blood in the water, again, the shark fin, and so on. And the thing is that what Spielberg was obsessed about, what his crew was obsessed about, was not actually the shark, was creating that thrilling atmosphere in the movie, the ambient that you're being chased yourself, that you don't know what's going to happen, and your mind would race, and it would create all of these scenarios. So the movie was, again, specialized in suspense. It wasn't specialized in sharks. And I think we are potentially seeing a very, very similar trend in decentralized applications. I think decentralized applications are also starting to specialize on their use case, on their utility, and I think the underlying technology for those applications will also follow suit by being increasingly specialized and custom to the use case that the technology is being used. And this is what I call the age of specialization. And I try to draw it here in a bit of a timeline. I think essentially the history of decentralized application is going through this phase, where we were in the beginning, like since 2008, and we were all passionate and obsessed about technology. How do you do this? How do you do that? How do you have more privacy? How do you scale more? That's all we talked about for like 10 years. And increasingly, there's bigger and bigger constraints and pressure happening on builder teams and on core teams. And those constraints happen because it's not so easy to raise anymore. It's kind of boring to airdrop all the time. We're starting to realize that actually you have to build a real utility and you have to really understand your users very well. And I think these constraints are actually also showing that we're going out of that period of intoxication with technology, the period where we're putting everything on blockchains and we're starting to think more deeply about what we're building. That's what I call specialization. So this is the next phase where now you're thinking about why are you doing it? Who do you do this for? And do you actually understand very, very deeply what you're doing? Do you understand the stack that you're using to build and so on? So I think it's the right direction in which the overall interchain is going. And I think it's actually more broadly than that. It's not only in the interchain in Cosmos, but it's actually the whole blockchain or Web3 movement, I would call it. So I think this is the most important trend as well, the trend that as soon as application builders embrace the constraints and they figure out what they're trying to build, they will need to adjust their stack just like Spielberg with his movie crew, they did with using just parts and the exact things that they needed to create suspense. And one last thing here is that it's very difficult. So specializing or finding product market fit, it's actually the most difficult thing that probably any business has ever done. And many businesses die at that stage. So it's an extremely messy and it takes a lot of determination. But I think it shows that we're serious. I think when we stop talking about speculation and we stop talking about just putting stuff on a blockchain, and we think about the core utility, that actually shows that we're doing something of that we're serious, we're taking our job seriously. So to give a bit more substance on these constraints and requirements, I actually think that in Interchain, in Cosmos more broadly, I think these are known, in particular the first point. So what I mean by constraints, and these are at a very high level because they're not the main point of my talk, I think the first one, also, I don't think these are reflected sufficiently in our narrative, in the broader narrative that we see going around. So the first one, which I think is actually the most important, at least for the moment, and it's also what explains that the interchain exists, it survived, is that one type of blockchain, whether it's infrastructure or not, is not enough. It cannot cut it for everyone. You cannot just have a global platform and everyone sitting there. It would be dystopian. And there's many reasons why that is the case. There's regulations, performance, retention policies, and so on. Then, these two points, which are actually a bit more depressing, but I don't think we're actually ready to deal with them, even though I do think that there's builders that understand these two points and that are maybe tackling them. Most people do not want to run nodes, and you kind of have to do that with most networks today, and self-custodial wallets are not for everyone. I'm mentioning these two mostly to give a bit of an understanding of the importance of what we're doing. And how difficult it is. And to stick essentially to my main point about interchain and so on, what I think is that once builder teams understand the constraints that they work with, and once we as core teams also understand what we're doing, I think it's inevitable and it's also necessary that applications get more and more differentiated from one another and they specialize on what they actually need to provide. To push on that point actually even more, I have this biased history of how I think decentralized applications have developed throughout the years. We started with Bitcoin, one environment, there's a single application, and a certain number of miners. Then we went to Ethereum, there's now multiple applications living in that environment, and validators securing it, and there's increasingly many more layers happening there. And in the interchain, what exists there, there's many environments. You can roughly think of an environment as an execution environment. And each of those has many applications. Sometimes it's just one. And of course, it's secured by validators and also can have increasingly many layers. What is really interesting about the interchain is that every application in there aims to be specialized versus these other two, or at least for the moment. Besides being specialized, they're also interoperable, and we will get there. So if I was going to refine the picture, I would do something like this. I would say this, these two are amazing, and they were the breakthroughs that got us here, probably. Also, by the way, they are themselves becoming increasingly specialized. They're starting to become more and more narrow into what we perceive them to be and what we think that they will serve us for in the future, Ethereum and Bitcoin. And the interchain, which has this, what I sketched here as these red arrows, it's interoperable. So what you get when you have specialized systems that are also interoperable with one another is what you got with the internet as well. It's the same pattern as going from a single computer where we all have to pay rent to like a centralized mainframe towards a world where everyone basically has a computer and you have the internet and you can connect freely to all the other computers. And I think that's amazing. That's why I also think that it's necessary, but I also think it's inevitable. So for the rest of the talk now, I will get a bit more technical now. Even though my main goal is actually to be able to present this to you and get more and more focused on the interchain stack and hope to convince you to join the roundtable tomorrow on the interchain public goods. But to the point here, we have applications that are increasingly being specialized, and this happens on many dimensions. So I'm starting here with basically very broad sweep across the interchain stack. And we see when we talk to builder teams, when we talk to application builders, we see that increasingly they want to specialize the data that they store, and they want to specialize the types that they use when building their applications. So you go from applications that have 1 gigabyte blocks towards applications that are very, very nimble and have very, very fast and rather small blocks. And it's a huge spectrum between that, and not all of them will use the same types of headers and blocks and so on. The storage requirements, the RPC and the indexing requirements for those two type of applications are wildly different. One of them doesn't even need an RPC and an indexer. For the other one that has huge blocks, the RPC and access to those blocks is like the most important thing that you can do. To give examples, Celestia is the one that has the huge block requirement, and Say has, on the other hand, the smaller block requirements, but they want to produce blocks very, very, very fast. Then there's, of course, at the level of block construction constraints and specialization. There's MEV, which everyone spent the last 3 years thinking about, and now we're not that enamored with it anymore, but it will become again important, and there's still businesses being built about MEV, around MEV. So how do you construct blocks is very important to that. Who constructs it, who finalizes, and how many construct a block, and how many finalize a block that was constructed, which has to do with censorship resistance, finalization, which I just mentioned, and the execution model, which is something quite peculiar to Comet BFT that I won't get into details. But that's also a pretty interesting way in which applications are starting to specialize. At the network layer, of course, there's networks that have certain topological or geographical requirements, and some of them they just want to operate on the whole world. In a rather undifferentiated way. There's, of course, efficiency also, and how do you synchronize with the network? Synchronizing with the network is very difficult because it depends a lot on how many upgrades the network underwent, for instance. And maybe one of the favorite topic or the favorite area of specialization of applications, at least these days, it's performance. There's performance both at the consensus algorithm and at the gossip or the entropy, anti-entropy layer of the network. And there's also interoperability, which I will mention in the next slide. And essentially what we're noticing when you're doing this sort of, this is essentially a generalization from years of conversations with application builder teams. And what we're noticing, and this goes into the 2024 roadmap for the public goods, what we're noticing is that that we need to provide to application builders increasingly higher levels of flexibility and modularity. And just one word about the interchain stack. I hope no one really needs an intro. What I will focus now is going away from the problem space to closer to the solution space. And I will focus mostly on Comet BFT and IBC. And what I'm trying to provide here is the link between what the applications needed. They need to specialize in all of those ways, block, MEV, performance, and what the core infrastructure is going to provide to them. On Comet BFT side, I explicitly cut this out so that I'm giving you a small incentive to join us tomorrow at 10 a.m. Also, because the only thing that is actually relevant for my talk, the other one are also relevant, but this is crucially relevant, is that on Comet BFT for the 2024 plans, we have the first most important strategic theme is this. We want builders to be able to address a wider range of use cases than currently possible. Put differently, builders are doing what Steven Spielberg did with his movie. They're just looking at the things that they have at hand and they think, how can I use this in more and more specialized way for my use case? So in order for builders to do that, we need to work on Comet and making it more flexible and modular. So what are we doing in that respect? Some specific plans that we decided would be really relevant would be to modularize the consensus engine. This is a big technical debt that exists in the codebase. The codebase actually has no one single architecture. The codebase has something like 10 architectures. It has drifted so much in time. So that needs to be reconciled, and you need to be able to explain and get an overview of what Comet BFT does through a single picture. And that is very difficult at the moment. That is roughly what we mean by modularizing it. So that you can swap out components, you can disable components, you can introduce new components if you want. The next one is actually inspired directly from Celestia requirement. They believe that it's crucially important for DA layers to be able to synchronize from the genesis of a network through upgrades of that network with a single binary. That's not possible at the moment. It's actually quite tricky. And then there's three points that I think will influence how the next iteration on the ABCI interface looks like. The three points are giving same block execution support. So currently in Comet BFT, the execution of a block is only reflected in the next block. And that's a pretty big problem also for IBC, but for other reasons as well. The next one would be giving applications peer-to-peer access via ABCI. This is because applications want to do increasingly more stuff with the networking layer. Currently, all that the application can do is just receive ordered transactions, roughly speaking. And instead of just doing that, the applications also want to be able to broadcast across all the nodes in the network. And broadcast would happen with best effort reliability guarantees. And the last one is something that is experimental, so we actually don't even know if it's going to work, but we're very excited to see where it leads. It's experimental IBC support directly in the consensus engine. This is inspired by several application builder teams that do not use the Cosmos SDK, and they use Comet BFT, but yet they're just these islands. They're stranded islands because Comet doesn't have IBC enabled yet, or put it differently, IBC is not able to work with Comet BFT. So we're looking whether we cannot just put IBC as a sidecar to Comet. So that was on the Comet BFT side. And then I also mentioned that I will get back to this point about interoperability. So this is a second way in which we notice applications being increasingly specialized. And this is more focused on how do they specialize on the interoperability front. They look for increasingly more execution environments. And this is very difficult from an interoperability perspective because you need to be able to reason about what the other party executed and did not execute. Applications also want to have nowadays modular blockchain stacks instead of having the monolithic way in which you run a node. And that implies different types in which you prove what you executed. And then the last two, which I will go into a bit more detail, we have demanding more specialization on the security front. Security is very important for when we talk about interoperability, and on the composability front, which is a bit at odds with interoperability, and I'll mention what that means in a second. So on the security front, you all know about the Interchain security that has launched earlier this year. You all know that there's different consumer chains. We call them DAWEI, and there's the security provider chain, and I just sketched them here as these white blocks, and each of them is specialized in something. Each of them tries to do something different than the hub would not be able to do, and should not do, actually. So what is important, and I think we all know also, is that these are governance gated, and they're essentially, they function as a security agreement. Like, I give you this, you give me that. I give you security, you give me a chunk of what you specialize on, essentially. And there's something really interesting here, which is that there's a lot of work that I think is not actually being recognized or it's not really understood well in the ecosystem. I know this directly from the Hermes team, who's working with the Hub team, that there's very, very tricky attacks that can happen. It's very difficult to test them, to recreate them. And this is why I mentioned that it's a specialization on security. And this is a pressure that it's put from the Interchain security perspective. Other networks do not need this. Interchain security needs this very, very specifically. Other networks need a bit of a subset of this misbehavior detection, what I mentioned here. Okay, and the last one, the last kind of area of specialization is the mega blocks design. Jehan sometimes calls this composability, sometimes calls it atomic IBC, if you ever joined any of the Twitter spaces that the Cosmos Hub team at Informal has hosted in the last few months. And this is one of my favorite examples of how things get increasingly specialized and different. No one actually would need this except for the economic zones around the hub. And we actually don't even know what is the best model. It's an extremely complex problem that has a very, very wide space of design. And roughly speaking, in the first iteration of how we're thinking about it, at least this is what Jehan is thinking about, is that there will be a single Comet VFT instance that would produce mega blocks, and these mega blocks would be shared by multiple networks at the same time. Actually, there's other systems out there that share architectural similarities with this one. And the advantage would be that these networks would have essentially atomic access, and they would be able to consume the output of transactions from other networks. So I am Stride, I'm executing a transaction, the next network that is a consumer there could consume my output in the same block. So it's a super interesting design. I think it will undergo changes. There's no final understanding on how we will be doing it, actually. And yeah, this is research in progress. Cool, I want to get back to my main point. That was that all we could see here, we didn't even see the shark here, and yet if you watched the movie, your heart would be pounding because you knew that the shark was going for the boat. And I think this was a fantastic way for the movie crew and Spielberg who filmed this to think about the uniquely differentiated product that they were building. They were building a movie that was specialized in suspense. And I think the same is happening in the Interchain and more broadly, and I'm very excited about it. Like I tried to also convince you, there's a lot of things that need to be modified on the Interchain stack level, the different building blocks that we have. And this leads me to my last slide, that I just want to mention a couple of things about informal systems. We see these changes because we are at the public goods level operating very often, but we're not only there. So informal systems is a 60-person cooperative, roughly 60, I think. We're passionate. Whenever we pitch the company, this is how we pitch it with, and this is what we believe in. We believe we are essentially transforming three key elements of our society, money, software, and organizations. And we have three ways in which we do that, or three units within Informal that specialize each of them on one of these three areas. So I'll start with, which one is it? I'll start with the organizations. On the organization front, we're helping build decentralized organizations, essentially, through the Interchain stack. That's how we're revolutionizing organizations. So we have Comet BFT, we have the Rust stack in IBC, and that's what we're stewarding, and the Cosmos Hub team, which I mentioned. Then, on the area of transforming software, we have the second unit, which specializes in security audits. Go see Igor's talk about Quint. I think it's tomorrow at 10 a.m. Conf. There you go. Also the same person who invented Apalachee. So that would be on the area of transforming software to make it more resilient, make it more trustworthy, because we cannot build decentralized institutions unless they're also trustworthy, essentially. And on the area of transforming money, you saw Baki's talk this morning. It's about the liquidity savings venture in informal systems. And that would be it. I'd be super happy to take any questions if there's any. Otherwise, again, make it tomorrow at the Cosmos Public Goods Roundtable that the Interchain Foundation is organizing.